Today, the president has on his desk a bipartisan National Defense Authorization Bill. The bill provides our troops with the resources they need to keep America safe. And it meets the funding levels that the president requested. Yet the president has vowed to veto it. Why? Because he wants to stop and spend more money on his domestic agenda. It's time to put our troops first. It's time to stop playing political games. Iranian terrorists soon are going to have access to billions of dollars as a result of the president's nuclear deal. There's no time to block funding for our troops in the critical mission that they have ahead.
Good morning, all. Quickly give you a little snapshot of what we have this week. I know we've got a lot going on, a lot of other issues you probably want to talk about, but there's a couple bills I want to highlight. First, I want to highlight one of the bills that the Speaker has fought his entire career for. Many of you have children and others. It's no longer what you become, it's the opportunity your children have. And there's one unique thing about America, that every generation has improved on the generation before it. That we care for those that maybe have less than us. An idea that you have a low-income student doesn't get held back, has the opportunity of a choice, maybe to go to a private school that somebody else that have income could. We used to have that here in D.C., something that the Speaker had worked on. When the President came in, he changed that. So we will pass that bill this week. We'll also take up Tom McClintock's bill to make sure a default prevention act, that we do not default on any of the principal or interest payments. That we know as America, we'd never want to do that. But there was one bill that you're going to have the chairman come up here from Armed Services, Mac Thornberry. This is a bipartisan bill. It's the National Defense Authorization Act. It has a history of being bipartisan. The Speaker did an enrollment assignment, sending it to the President. Never in the history have we ever had a President say he wants to veto a bill of this nature on something that's not even in the bill. We should never get to the point in this country where we play politics with our troops. This deals with the future, it deals with the security, it also deals with the payment of how we treat them. I know there's problems in Washington, but it should never get that low. I hope the President reconsiders.
Yesterday we sent President Obama the National Defense Authorization Act. This bill was worked through the committee process. Chairman Thornberry and so many others worked in a very bipartisan way to put together a bill that not only makes sure that our troops are properly funded, increases their pay, makes sure that Guantanamo Bay inmates are not sent to America and given American rights, does so many other things to protect America's safety abroad where there's an incredibly dangerous world, actually gives real tools to our allies like the Ukraine, who want to push back against Russia's aggression. This bill was a strong bipartisan bill that deserves the President's signature, not the threat of a politically charged veto. The President needs to reconsider his veto threat, do what's right for our troops and what's right for America's national security, and sign this bill. We're also going to be voting later this week on the reconciliation legislation. This is a bill that we worked through going back to January, when our members came together and recognized that with a House and Senate majority, we had the first time since 2002 to pass a budget that actually gets to balance, but also to give us that tool of reconciliation, which allows us with 51 votes in the Senate rather than 60 to send a bill to the President's desk. We've done that. We've come together in the House to bring a bill to the floor that actually dismantles Obamacare and defunds Planned Parenthood, allowing us with 51 votes in the Senate to send that bill to the President's desk. So I'm looking forward to a very strong vote from the House. Would urge the Senate to follow suit and go through their process and send that bill to the President's desk, a bill that really re-strengthens the priorities of the American people, would help get our economy back on track and set some really good priorities for our country.
Mm-hmm. This week, the House and Senate sent the defense bill, as you've heard, to the President's desk. It was bipartisan, and it is legislation that we pass every year to fund our military. This legislation is essential when it comes to providing a strong national defense that keeps us safe, that equips those that are in harm's way and also supports the families of those military servicemen and women. For the men and women at Fairchild Air Force Base in Eastern Washington, as well as bases all around the world, our priority should be to give them the equipment and the resources that they need. I also co-chair the Military Family Caucus, and I hear regularly from military families concerns about whether they're going to be able to make ends meet at the end of the month, and whether or not they're going to be able to juggle the demands when someone is deployed. When someone joins the military, it's not just a job. It is a family commitment that they make to our country. They all make sacrifices, they serve us, and it is our responsibility to make sure that they get our support. Military families rely on these programs. And when you really think about it, caring for our troops and their families is the cornerstone of military readiness. Our troops need to be the focus. And we shouldn't have them worrying about whether or not we're going to be supporting them back home. We have an obligation. The president, the commander-in-chief, has an obligation to ensure that military and defense remains our top priority. Mr. President, sign this bill.
Thank you, Tom. I, too, am deeply disappointed President Obama has threatened to veto the bipartisan defense authorization bill. To be clear, the president threatens to veto increases to troop pay and benefits, enhancements to the military's retirement system, a reinforced mission to defeat ISIL, funding for our nation's military personnel and readiness, and the necessary resources for a strong national defense that even reflects the president's own budget request. For the first time in our nation's history, a president is holding this bill for ransom in pursuit of more money for his political agenda. This includes transferring Guantanamo Bay detainees to the United States and potentially Northeast Kansas. Representing Fort Leavenworth, I know this is not in our nation's best interest, yet President Obama would prefer to move the world's most deadly terrorist to our communities rather than to pay our men and women in uniform. Mr. President, troop pay and our nation's security is no place to play politics.
Among the headlines today is Bashar al-Assad going to Moscow to thank Mr. Putin for saving his regime. 22 Afghan policemen were murdered by the Taliban. An F-18 apparently crashed in England. Meanwhile, there are thousands of men and women strapping on their body armor, getting ready to go on patrol, fly their aircraft to protect the United States. It would be absolutely wrong for us to play political games with them and with the support that they depend upon. As has been mentioned, included in this bill is a reform for military retirement. Today, 83% of the people who serve in the military walk away with no retirement. This bill changes that. There are reforms that make sure that if someone is on a drug when they are in the military to treat post-traumatic stress or pain management, they can stay on the same drug when they move to the VA system. That's not happening today. There are a number of reforms that are beginning to improve the way that the Pentagon buys goods and services. All of that goes away with a veto of this bill. It would be unprecedented. It is time for the president to put our troops and national security first. He should sign the bill.
Well, young lady.
You've dealt with the Freedom Caucus for a long time, so what do you
really
think the chances are that they will acquiesce to Paul Ryan's demands or requests, as he puts it?
Listen, I think Paul Ryan would make a great speaker. But this decision is up to the members, and I thought last night went very well, and hopefully by the end of the week we'll have a nominee.
What's Plan B if he doesn't decide to join on Friday?
Don't know. I should say, and I should have said earlier, I did announce to the members that the conference election for Speaker will be next Wednesday, and the 28th, and on Thursday, the 29th, the election will occur on the floor. Okay.
But following up on that, could you kind of project around the corner here? I mean, you've gone through now, you leaving, McCarthy leaving, Ryan stepping up.
Okay, I'm still staying.
Is there a viable second, third, whatever this would be option?
Listen, I think Paul is going to get the support that he's looking for. But he laid out a very clear vision of how he would run the speakership, and I thought the members responded very well to it.
You'll support him. Mr.
Speaker. Yes.
Mr. Speaker, thank you. But, you know, per Jake's question, we've had so many fits and starts with this. You said the 28th and the 29th. Why should we have any confidence that this is going to work out this time? I mean, what is your level of confidence that it's going to work out?
I feel pretty good about it.
You do? What?
Mr. Speaker, I hope it's not our last press conference, by the way. We'll have one more next week.
I'm sure we will.
But you see the mobilization now on the right against Paul Ryan, saying he's pro-amnesty, he's not conservative enough. He's just another McCarthy. He's just another Boehner. How does that sit with you?
Listen, I've got pretty thick skin, and but we all know Paul Ryan, right? He's a very good member. He works hard. He's very bright. And he has good relationships, I think, with all the wings of the party. So that's why I think he'll be doing fine. Yes, ma'am.
About the fundraising aspect of the draw. He would like to spend more time with his family. You are the fundraiser par excellence. What's your sense about whether that job can actually be restructured so that he's not the main fundraiser?
No, I think there's a way to do that, and I frankly outlined over the last week or so a way that Paul could do this differently than the way I did.
And what would that be?
Well, we'll let him decide. Yes, sir.
As you depart and you look back at your time here, what message, if any, do you have to the House Freedom Caucus after they united against you and they did the same against Mr. McCarthy despite his own efforts to win their support? What message do you have to them now as they consider uniting against Paul Ryan?
Listen, if this is not about us, not about us as leaders, not about us as members. Our job is to do the right thing for the American people every day. And you've heard me say this multiple times, but I'll say it one more time. If you do the right things every day for the right reasons, the right things will happen for our country. Thanks.